All right. Good afternoon, everybody. I hope you had a good lunch, and that I hope you took a little bit of a nap because it's right in the middle of the afternoon, and I hope you'll be awake for the next hour. If not, Laura Vogt will come down, and she will personally ask you to join the museum as a member. So stay awake. I also want to thank Doran Cart for his introduction and for all the work that he's done here in the 24 and a half years to really make this a landmark, not only for history of World War I, but for American history and world history more generally. I think this is a real precious resource, and I need to thank him in particular, as well as, of course, everybody else here at Liberty Memorial. So there are those who would say that in a conference devoted to the years 1914 and 1915, that there's no particular place for a talk about the United States, or that you could really just take care of this question in about a sentence or two with a dutiful reference to the campaign slogan, "He kept us out of war." Now, I am here today to convince you otherwise and to show, using a bunch of examples, some of them quite familiar and some of them, I hope, quite unfamiliar or new at least to you, that Americans were deeply engaged in the First World War, even if America was not as a nation. Now, President Wilson certainly knew that in August of 1914. He was, in fact, actually concerned about how quickly the conflicts of the war in Europe would come to the United States. He warned that Americans, quote, may be divided in camps of hostile opinion, involved in the war itself in impulse and opinion, if not in action. Now, there was plenty of impulse, there was plenty of action, there was plenty of opinion. The European war pushed some to don uniforms and fight, some to care for wounded soldiers and feed hungry refugees, and others to insist that the United States actually stay out of the devastating war across the Atlantic. Americans were deeply engaged in World War I long before the US officially joined the war. They were prompted by individual cultural commitments to Britain or France, to Germany or the Austro-Hungarian Empire. They were motivated by personal ambition and romance. They were prompted by a search for adventure or a prayerful hope for the redemption of Europe. So my talk today has three parts: observation, donation, action. Right? Three things that Americans did during the years 1914 and 15. And it considers these as engaged reactions, engaged responses to the European war at a crucial moment in US history. Now, I want to look both at the Western Front and also at the Western Hemisphere. I'm going to talk a bit about Mexico, and I'm going to talk a little bit about Canada, two places that often get left out of histories of the First World War. And I want to convey two points. First, neutrality did not mean apathy. That official government neutrality did not mean that Americans didn't do anything, right? And second, what they did do, observation, donation, action, had enormous, enduring, and in fact sometimes quite unexpected political consequences for the rest of the 20th century. All right, so let's start with observation, right? And I want to start where most Americans started when the war began. In some ways, we looked at what was happening in Europe on the day before the war, and what is the American experience? And during the First World War, people everywhere clamored for maps. They read atlases, they tore maps out of newspaper supplements, and they even gathered around public displays of maps on kiosks in town square. Now, what you're looking at here is the Seattle Star on August 1st, 1914, and then this headline, which if you can't read it, says, "Cut out this map and follow moves of European war." Right? Sort of encouraging people, right, to teach themselves about what was happening. Right? And they were looking for the war, curious to find places like Sarajevo and Gallipoli, Verdun and Versailles, hopeful that tracing the shifts of battlefronts could make sense of the conflict's human devastation and its political significance. But I think as well, without even knowing it, they were in some ways also looking for themselves and finding a place for themselves in the war by finding a place for themselves on its maps. Now, they didn't just look at newspaper maps and headlines, they also watched the war very closely through the news. Right? And what you're looking at here are some early newsreel photographers. These are British newsreel cinematographers in 1916, I think, actually. And when Americans followed the news, they did not do so passively. Right? And sometimes things could get quite violent. In fact, there's a story of a group of Italian immigrants rioting at a movie theater in St. Louis after the display of a newsreel that was critical of Italy's conquest of Libya. So people could take their news quite seriously. And the news that they watched also was not innocently projected, but in fact was, by the fall of 1914, increasingly filtered through British lenses. And this is an important detail. That one of the first things that the British do is to cut the transatlantic cables and in many ways control the dissemination of news in the United States for much of the neutrality period. So most Americans are getting news that that is coming sort of either directly or indirectly from Britain, and that's shaping how they are observing this war. Observation was not merely spectatorship in this period. Observation also meant political engagement and opinion forming, which would have consequences. Right? Now, people then and now, as they are looked to find meaning in the world, they don't just look to the news, they could also turn to scripture. Right? And I think that it's important to sort of emphasize the religious aspects of the war and the ways that many people of faith sort of used scriptural text to understand what was happening. And this marks a period in the history of Christianity in particular when American religion is at a turning point in terms of how to engage with the world around it. This is coming about a generation after the introduction of the ideas of the social gospel, the idea that Christian teachings should be turned into social action, benevolence, into sort of charity. And we can see the roots of that in, or the culmination of that, in the YMCA and the Salvation Army and other kind of sort of faith-based organizations that provide charity and humanitarian aid at the Western Front and elsewhere. But there is a debate also among Christians about the meanings of the war, the meanings of Christianity, and also the meanings of how to read the Bible. Right? So the war also comes after a generation of theological fights over how literally the Bible should be read and how literally it speaks to its readers. And so one also important sort of thing that's happening during the neutrality period is the publication of these books, The Fundamentals, between 1910 and 1915. I have read some of them. I am not a theologian, but if you are not a theologian, you'll find this pretty dry and abstract sort of material. This is not a best-selling material. But it reflects an important debate about, like I said, about sort of how to read the Bible. Now, some of the most sort of the alternative to sort of literal scriptural interpretation was something known as higher criticism, right? An idea that the Bible is largely a metaphorical text and one that is a product of its historical times. The notions and the ideas behind that came in the late 19th century primarily from Germany and German theologians. So for Americans who did read their Bibles literally, who did think that they spoke directly from God, that the idea of higher criticism comes to be associated with Germany, and German wartime acts come to be depicted as uncivilized, as barbaric, and as fundamentally a threat to Christianity as a religion and Christendom as a civilizational enterprise. Right? Hence, the consequence of that in many ways, that the way in which Americans and others treat the war as a crusade, right? And the rhetorics of religiosity, the intense fervor with which people support it, with which they fight it, the appearance of words like barbarian, words like crusader, sort of the images of Joan of Arc that appear almost everywhere on the home front, both in the United States and elsewhere during the war. Right, so people are observing, they're looking, they're thinking, they're discussing, and this has an important legacy. And this is marked, the World War I era marks a real turning point in American evangelicalism. Right? And the fundamentals is what gives us the term fundamentalism. which sort of would mark the development of evangelical Christianity through much of the next few decades. Right? So as all of this is going, Americans are also observing the world around them, and they are watching their borders. And I want to switch now to the southern border of the United States and say that the word observation had special urgency for Americans who lived along the U.S.-Mexico border in the 1910s. And I think historians have actually not done enough to incorporate the Mexican Revolution, a series of revolutions and civil wars from 1910 to 1920, into our history of the First World War. Right? But for Americans in this neutrality period, and particularly for Americans in the Southwest, those two things were inextricably linked, that what was happening in Mexico and what was happening in Europe were not actually different events, although historians in the century since have tended to distinguish them. So let me take a look at that. And I'm going to point out a few examples that come from this period, from some research that I've done in Texas, but certainly other areas of the Southwest and California you could see similar things. Now, first of all, you have sort of long-term demographic shifts in South Texas, that what had once been a sparsely populated ranching area dominated by Tejano families had become a densely populated agricultural region where most of the land is controlled by white landowners who are dependent on migrant Mexican labor and who have installed an increasingly rigid system of racial hierarchy. Right? So the region is changing drastically. Now, the second fact is that there's plenty of border crossing happening by Mexican revolutionaries. That the revolution, in fact, had initially been declared from north of the border by political exiles in 1910. And as different factions seized and lost power in Mexico over the course of the revolution, they fled to Texas and used it as a safe haven for those who were out of power. And they also used Texas as a place to recruit new revolutionaries for the revolution. Now, the number of revolutionary cadres crossing the border was actually quite small, especially in comparison to thousands of Mexican refugees, perhaps as many as 120,000, who fled from Mexico to the United States during these years. Remember, in Mexico there is war, there is revolution, this leads to famine, this leads to displacement, seizures of crops, and people flee across the border. Right? Now, this humanitarian crisis of more than 100,000 people into South Texas and California does not actually register the sort of massive response that we'll see when I talk about Belgium in a minute. And I think it's been was sort of left off the radar in the 1910s and has been left out of history in the years since. Now, the fourth thing that happens is that the troops of the various revolutionary factions that are operating in northern Mexico need to feed themselves, right? That the army moves on its stomach. And what had been a long-standing problem of cattle rustling becomes an epidemic of crime and plunder on the northern and more peaceful side of the border. Now, more importantly, these troops also needed weapons. And despite the announced intention of the United States to enforce international neutrality laws and to sort of keep the border clean and peaceful and neutral, the border very quickly became a site of a thriving gun smuggling industry, some of it conducted under the supervision of corrupt U.S. law enforcement officers themselves. So perhaps it's no surprise then that the Mexican Revolution spilled over the border to the United States. And as that happened, many South Texans became convinced that the region was declining into war, and more specifically, into a war that they did not separate from what was happening in Europe. Now, part of why they connect these two is a fear of conspiracy. And as we learned this morning, right, just because not everything is a conspiracy doesn't mean there really aren't conspiracies. So there were conspiracies here as well. Some were quite local in nature, but some were much more substantial. Including the one that draws the most attention in 1915, the revelation of a secret plan of San Diego, which is named not after a town in Texas, not after one in California, which was revealed in January of 1915, in which a group of Mexican revolutionaries sought to unify Mexicans, African Americans, Native Americans, and Japanese Americans in a plan to seize 11 Western states and parcel out the territories to each of these ethnic groups by reclaiming them from white settlers. Now, many Texans initially considered the plan too outlandish to fear, and a federal judge dismissed a sedition indictment against one of the conspirators as, quote, ludicrous. But as the unrest continues, as the refugees come, as the violence continues, as the plundering continues, Anglo Response grew increasingly panicked and increasingly violent. Now, many in Texas called for federal intervention to protect them from cross-border raiders, but they didn't get it, at least in 1915. The Wilson administration was very much guided and bound by international law and feared triggering an all-out war with Mexico that Wilson felt the United States could not and should not fight. And so the federal government rejected most requests for troops along the border in 1914 and 15, insisting that since much of the criminal activity that was happening was the work not of Mexican border crossers, but of Tejanos, who were US citizens, that border raids were better left as matters for state and local enforcement. As the Brownsville Daily Herald noted in 1915, quote, the bandits belong on this side of the border, and their depredations constitute a local affair and do not threaten international complications. Right? So many people in Texas are feeling sort of powerless and vulnerable, both Anglo and Tejano people. And many believe that the fundamental rights of self-government justified self-defense when the federal government would not act. And so you see the emergence along the Texas border of numerous organizations designed to protect against invasion and subversion. In the small town of Sebastian, locals formed the Sebastian Law and Order League. Thousands joined the Special Rangers, which was a voluntary auxiliary to the Texas Rangers. By this point, the Texas Rangers are a professional sort of policing force. During the 1910s, men volunteered as special deputy sheriffs, and both men and women enrolled in something called home rifle clubs to defend themselves by arms. The mayor of San Benito required the registration of every man between 21 and 60 for possible militia duty and took a registered count of all the town's firearms, partly to identify militiamen and partly to track gun smuggling. Now, Latinos in the US on the northern side of the border responded as well, and they were not passive in this as well. What you see here are some images of a newspaper called La Cronica, which is one of the first publications of sort of political, advocating for Latino political rights in this period, and drew on something called El Primer Congreso Mexicanista, which was dedicated to achieving political and legal rights for Mexican-American citizens, and particularly asserting their US citizenship at a time when sort of when citizenship matters a lot more on the border, right? That many many Mexicans and Mexican Americans had moved easily across the border in these years and would have been identified more by their ethnicity, but as the revolution makes borders matter and makes citizenship matter, now you start to see Mexican Americans start to assert their U.S. citizenship and to do so in political terms. The Congreso had first met in Laredo in 1911 and expands over the course of the war years and into the 1920s, reformulates as something called LULAC, the League of United Latin American Citizens, which is sort of one of the foundational organizations for Latino politics, something akin to what the NAACP was also doing in the 1910s. Right? So this story, I'm going to take you in this story only up to about 1915, because what happens next, of course, is that these tensions boil over quite dramatically. In 1916, after raids by Pancho Villa inside the United States, Wilson does actually authorize military activity both along the border and across the border in the so-called punitive expedition led by General Pershing. And then of course it boils over again in February of 1917 with the publication of the Zimmerman Telegram. And again, come back to the ideas of conspiracy. Right, the Zimmerman Telegram, in which German diplomats promised the return of the southwestern United States to Mexico in exchange for their wartime support. Right, so what we can see is that the Zimmerman Telegram is not the sort of exogenous event that kind of hits like a bolt of lightning in 1917. It's the culmination of years of violence and crisis that Americans were observing and watching. Right, that Wilson's official policy was of watchful waiting, right, which could very well be the title of my talk this afternoon. But it certainly gives a sense of what was happening in Mexico, right? So now, what are the consequences of all of these forms of observation? Three things come to mind, right? First, an expansion of global mindedness. All of this reading the news, all of this looking at maps, sort of generates a way of that Americans are thinking of themselves in the world, right? All that map reading definitely mattered. Second, we see transformations in culture and identity, whether you look at sort of Mexican-Americans claiming an American heritage, whether you look at evangelicals and social gospel activists sort of fighting over what Christianity means. And third, a sense of urgency to border surveillance. Right? Observation, in some ways, becomes a form of border surveillance that I would suggest culminates in the years after the war in the creation in 1924 of the US Border Patrol. Right? So all of these are sort of issues that very much preoccupy us in 2014, and I think they have very important roots in the years a century ago. All right, so let's switch now to part two, right? Observation, donation. Right? And here, Americans responded to the war, as I think many of us would do when we hear news of tragedies somewhere far away, by giving money. Right? And here you see an image. This is the official song of the Allied Bazaar, which was a fundraising sort of event, with the title "Someone Has to Pay," right? Which might also have been the title of Laura's sort of call for National World War I membership a few minutes ago, right? "Someone Has to Pay," right? And Americans responded eagerly and actively then. I hope they will respond eagerly and actively now. But of course, it's very easy to criticize the donation of money. And today we have a word for it, we call it slacktivism, right? The idea that, oh, if you just give some money or click like on your Facebook page for a political cause, right, you're not really doing anything, right? This is not activism, this is slacktivism. But I want to suggest that, in fact, all of this sort of mobilization of resources, and I'm going to talk not just about time, money, but also about time, not that it made a real difference. It didn't just add resources to a system of charity and benevolence that was already in place. In fact, it created that modern system of benevolence and charity and brought it into the 20th century in ways that aligned it with the modern institutions and professions. And this would make a big difference, again, in the long term. Now, President Woodrow Wilson had requested Americans to be, quote, neutral in thought and in action. But in fact, they rarely were, that they responded actively to the war. Within a year, Americans had set up nearly 100 volunteer organizations in Europe. Large-scale institutions distributed food, clothing, and medicine to wounded soldiers and to civilian refugees. Young men left jobs or put college careers on hold to drive ambulances. Women traveled to Europe to operate hospitals or steer relief trucks. Right, out of this emerged what we might identify as modern humanitarian aid. This was a transformation of a 19th century system of charity that was located primarily in domestic situations. If you think about it, it's almost never that an American volunteers outside the United States before 1914 as anything other than a missionary. After 1914, international volunteerism is par for the course. It is also much more institutional, much more organized, in which large-scale organizations adopt corporate forms in order to achieve logistical outcomes that basically modernize charity just as industry had been modernized a generation before. It is also often quite more explicitly secular, right? I had said that certainly much of it is motivated by religious institutions, by missionary impulses, but some of it could be framed in secular terms as well. And modern humanitarianism could also be wrapped up into the diplomatic concerns of nation states, that governments start to realize that that volunteerism matters, that it has an impact, that it is political, and in fact, participants in international volunteerism also understood the political consequences of what they were doing. That this donation is not innocent. It is deeply engaged and deeply political. Now, I could give you all 100 examples of these organizations, but I'm going to just talk about a couple. And I'm going to start here with the Commission for Relief in Belgium, probably the largest and perhaps one of the most familiar of these. What I like to say is that what you are looking at here, I like to say you're looking at a pirate ship. Because in fact, as one British commentator described the commission, it was, quote, a piratical state organized for benevolence. Right? That this was a large-scale organization that operated its own fleet of ships and crossed the blockades of the belligerent powers in order to deliver food and other things, including medical supplies, to civilians in Belgium. It had to carefully maneuver the laws of war and the sort of political aims of the belligerent powers, but it did so quite successfully. It maintained its demeanor of neutrality under the careful watch of the German officers who were afraid that it was really actually a pro-Allied organization. By the war's end, it had distributed nearly 6 million tons of food to over 9 million civilians in occupied Belgium and northern France. And that's basically almost the entire population of those regions. It reached almost every single person in the occupied area. With all kinds of things, right, including most notably flour. What you're looking at here are flour sacks sort of mobilized and donated or sold by particular counties and communities. You can see Kentucky and Indiana as well as some places here, as well as some in Ontario, Canada, gift from Ontario, Canada to the people of Belgium. You know, this mobilizes great attention. And of course, it turned its founder, a little known but incredibly wealthy sort of 40-year-old mining executive by the name of Herbert Hoover, into a national celebrity, right? And this is a point that I like to make several times, that almost every other war in American history has generated as a post-war president the general of its armies. The First World War gives us not President Pershing, but President Hoover. Right, that he becomes the symbol of what America is and what America can do. He also is the one with the political capital to turn that into an elected office in 1928. And history has not been kind to him because of everything that happens after his election in 1928. But certainly in the 1910s, he is regularly voted one of the most admired men in America. The CRB raised enormous amounts of funds, and it also did so not just with donations, but by getting subsidies from governments, right? So I think what you want to see here in the CRB is not just the mobilization of individual small donations or sacks of grain, right? But also the ways in which it is actually sort of engaging in kind of diplomacy, engaging in state-like behavior, trying to capitalize on the neutrality to get that done. Right, now, nearly 6,000 American volunteers served in France during the neutrality period. And they were really some of the most visible people to the American public. In August of 1914, the American Ambulance Hospital in the prosperous Paris suburb of Neuilly became the hub for American activity in France. The hospital attracted American nurses who offered to work without pay, and medical teams by leading physicians such as surgeon Harvey Cushing, who brought a Harvard medical unit to Neuilly in 1915. Groups were dispatched by many universities, including the University of Pennsylvania and Western Reserve University in Ohio, and they brought the latest medical technology with them to treat wounded soldiers. Now, medical relief would soon, over the next year or so, expand from the Western Front to other places, to Italy, to the Balkans, to the Near East, and I think many of the sort of international medical aid organizations that we take for granted today, Doctors Without Borders, CARE, Partners in Health, other kinds of things that, you know, might appear on your sort of annual giving list, are institutions that that may not trace their roots back to this moment, but certainly are born out of this model of international humanitarian medical assistance. Now, there were plenty of American expatriates in Paris. Some of them were business leaders versed in transatlantic trade. Some of them were wealthy individuals. And many of them formed organizations in Paris, where they were living, in order to connect with Americans, in order to access their money and their resources to aid people in France. The most visible of these was the American Fund for French Wounded, which was founded in early 1915 by Isabel Stevens Lathrop, Anna Marie Vale, and other American women who had very close ties to Paris. And they raised a great deal of funds, and including by selling sort of things like this. What you are looking at here on the left is a box of matches, and this is, I think, a soap dish. So there's sort of like a kind of a sort of material culture of charity that certainly we're familiar with today, that the American Fund for French Wounded is mobilizing. They gathered clothes and other goods in the United States and sent them through the work of American branches and volunteer groups to hospitals and other communities in France. Now, probably nothing symbolized transatlantic volunteerism as vividly to American audiences as ambulance drivers. Right? And in 1914, A. Pyatt Andrew, a 41-year-old assistant, former assistant secretary of the U.S. Treasury, formed another organization, the American Ambulance Field Service, which initially worked with the hospital at Neuilly to meet hospital trains arriving from Paris. But soon after that, individual ambulance car units broke away from Paris to serve directly with the French army closer to the trenches. Now, what you're looking at here is not an AFS ambulance. It's the American Volunteer Ambulance Corps. It's also it's a Rolls-Royce. So many of these were, in fact, actually quite prosperous individuals. For the most part, they drove Model T Fords, and in fact, you can see one in the museum hall here, that were paid for by donors in the United States or out of their own pockets, because, among other things, aggressively anti-war Henry Ford refused to donate Fords to the cause, insisting that the volunteers pay for them, because Ford was concerned that these volunteers were, through their actions, were dragging the United States into war on the side of France, that they were not actually truly neutral. Now, the work of being an ambulance driver could, in fact, be quite dangerous. What you are looking at here is the destroyed ambulance of one of the AFS drivers, Richard Hall, who died in 1915. More than 100 ambulance drivers died in accidents or when they got caught in the crossfire, often driving over rough terrain with no lights at night and no windshields. So this story becomes very much the kind of romantic narrative of international volunteerism during the war. It is also one that becomes increasingly male, despite the fact that substantial numbers of women served in either medical capacities and also served in some forms of driving activities. And here, if you can't read the headline, it says, "American Beauty, Now War Ambulance Driver." And in fact, actually, very few women actually drove ambulances at the front. They would have if they drove ambulances, they would have driven them behind the front lines, or they would have driven truck or other sort of car services behind the front lines. And these divisions started to create tensions, and that's why I call it the politics of volunteerism, because it was both a way in which men excluded women, but also a way in which women claimed their rights to participate as volunteers, and by doing so, stake a claim on equal citizenship. The American Fund for French Wounded's Isabel Lathrop thought it was unfair that male newcomers from the U.S. went immediately to the front for ambulance service, while, quote, "girls who work faithfully perhaps 6 months in this stupid work might still be toiling in the organization's packing room in Paris." Right? She felt frustrated that many of the volunteer jobs that were more clerical or more sort of routine were shunted off to female volunteers. Now, volunteerism became political in another sense, right? In that volunteers and their supporters back home slowly began to make their case for the Allies much more explicit, and especially over the course of 1915 and then in the run-up to the 1916 election. You see an outpouring of pro-Allied publications, visual images, events, those fundraisers and bazaars that celebrate the struggles of France and basically take sides with France. What you look at here is a film that was widely screened called Our American Boys in the European War. It was actually shot by the American Field Service with the aid of the French government. And well-known writers and intellectuals get involved as well. People like Edith Wharton and Henry James elicited not just humanitarian aid on a neutral basis, but explicit sympathy for the Allied cause. All right. One of the things we need to see here is not just the consequence that I mentioned before, how volunteerism is becoming more international, more professional, more systematic, and more political, but also to note that this is all happening in a very ad hoc way, that many of the organizations that were formed in the summer and fall, or the fall of 1914, were understood as temporary, immediate emergency responses to a crisis. Just as, you know, we often talk about how all of the generals thought that the war would be over by Christmas, right? The volunteers also thought that the war would be over by Christmas. They didn't know that they were setting out the sort of massive piratical state for benevolence. They didn't know that they were creating the modern sort of NGO. right? But over the course of the years, as they adapted to the realities, they transformed these institutions in much the same way that on the military side, people were adapting and creating new technologies, new ways of war fighting, et cetera. Right? All right, so the third thing I want to talk about is action. So in addition to observing the war from the home front, in addition to donating their money and their time, Americans also took action in one form or another, many of them in uniform. Now, not everyone joined up on the side of war, right? There were certainly many who chose peace and became active in support of peace. I mentioned Henry Ford and his opposition to the war. Among the things he did was to fund the so-called peace ship in 1915, which was a sort of coalition of peace activists, both men and women, from all of the different powers that sought to sort of find a negotiated settlement to the war. And you're looking at an image of this group here as it arrives in the Netherlands, which was their neutral nation where they could meet. And Jane Addams is among them. I think this is Jane Addams right here. Jane Addams is representing a series of organizations that would become the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. Peace organizations, in many ways, become much more active and organized in this period as well, particularly in the United States, where they feel devoted to ending the war through a negotiated settlement and keeping the United States out, in part by keeping Americans from taking up arms and acting in ways that would drag the United States into the war. There are also opponents of the war in the Socialist Party. Remember in 1912, the Socialist Party had polled over 1 million votes for its candidate, Eugene Debs. And certainly this is the high point of sort of activism in the Socialist Party at this period. The Socialists would go on in 1917 to be the only Socialist Party that actually maintained its anti-war status rather than taking up the sides of the warring nations. Some have said this is a sign of just how devoted and principled the socialists in the US were. It might also be a sign of just how small and marginal they were to American politics in that period. But certainly the anti-war organizations and radical organizations that would be crushed in 1919 in the Red Scare were crushed in part because they had spent those last few years organizing, both before and after 1917. But for all of that, peace activism definitely got shouted out by the movement for preparedness. And I'm not going to talk too much about this because I think you'll hear about it in some of the other talks. But led by, among others, Theodore Roosevelt, the great Rough Rider, and some of his allies, this called directly for the United States to expand its military, to sort of modernize its forces, to institute some form of military training or conscription. And so you have this very active and very divisive debate over military preparedness that's happening from 1915 and definitely through the years of the war. There are some who do not just train in the preparedness camps at Plattsburgh, New York, and elsewhere, but also who serve overseas. Some serve not only on the road, but also in the air. More than 180 Americans became pilots in the all-American flying squadrons of the French Army during the war, in the Lafayette Escadrille and others. Here you see an image, one image of them. Some of them were already veterans of the French Foreign Legion, among them Eugène Boulard, an African-American expatriate who was living in France when the war broke out in 1914 and took up arms for an adopted homeland that he embraced for its relative racial egalitarianism. Now, the Lafayette Escadrille has become the stuff of legend. And like I said, this reflects both the risks that the pilots took, but also the romance with which audiences in the United States received their stories as they returned to the United States to tell their stories in public speeches, newspapers, and memoirs, and which would become later the stuff of film, right? And so you have Tab Hunter in the Lafayette Escadrille. A generation later, you have James Franco in the same thing in Flyboys, right? So clearly, this is the kind of story that Hollywood not only liked at the time, but has liked in the generations since. The more realistic story about U.S. military service in foreign armies is in fact actually elsewhere. And if you follow the numbers, that the numbers lead us to other places. They lead us, first of all, to the substantial number of people in the United States in 1914 who were not Americans, right? Immigrants from some of the warring powers. And certainly we know some of the stories of Polish immigrants, of Italian immigrants, and others, many who went back to Europe to fight in the warring powers. I want to put this image here just because it's one we know very little about. These are German reservists who flocked to consulates, German consulates in American cities, in the very first days of the war to register for service in the army. Right? This is a photograph from Broadway in New York City on August 4th, 1914. Right, of German reservists, so from the very beginning. Now, few, if any, Germans actually made it back to Germany to fight on the German behalf. I actually don't know the details of this, so if anyone in the room does, I would want to know more about them. But certainly, we know much more about, like I said, about Italian, Polish, and some of the others who went back to the Austro-Hungarian regions as well. What I want to spend a little time talking about is the story of Canadians, right? Or Americans who fought in the Canadian Armed Forces. And this is a headline, and I like the title because it's sort of the argument of my talk today. American Legion in the Canadian Army shows all US citizens are not neutral. Right? So, you know, if I had a thesis statement, that would be it. And tens of thousands, the specific number we may never quite know, and I'll talk about that in a second, served in the Canadian Army. Now, there were actually Canadian forces in the United States. The Canadians did not invade the U.S. I think, you know, we although we have drawn up war plans for that eventuality, it has not yet come to pass. But Canadian pilots trained at a training facility in Texas. They were training for service in the Royal Flying Corps and through an agreement. And so the US and Canada had military agreements with one another. But that's the small number. The larger number is the Americans who crossed the border to Canada in order to enlist in the Canadian forces. And the key person, and many of them ended up, and many of them ended up taking training like the men in this picture. Now, the key figure behind all of this is Sir Sam Hughes, who is in charge of military recruitment in Canada. And he desperately wanted to recruit US soldiers. And on August 25th, 1914, he cabled London saying that, quote, many Canadian and American aviators offering service for the war, latter offer to come to Canada and enlist here. And in fact, he sent another cable saying, I can get you 60,000 men, basically, you know, if you will let me recruit the Americans. And at the War Office in London, Lord Kitchener wrote back to say he was, quote, proud to have the help of men who wish to fight with us against the forces of military despotism. But Kitchener was proud only, or, you know, only in theory, eager only in theory, and warned Hughes not to recruit Americans directly into the Canadian Armed Forces, lest German spies slip in among the mist, and lest Hughes's overeager recruiting would violate international agreements and US law. Right? So there is actually a law against this, which is the Foreign Enlistment Act of 1818, which is still with amendments in force today, which makes service in a non-US armed force a criminal offense and grounds for the loss of US citizenship. Now, that didn't stop many Americans from joining. In fact, they just went ahead and did it. And in fact, they did so with help from the Canadian government. Canada set up a recruiting office on Fifth Avenue in New York and in several other places and advertised in US magazines, but it did so officially on paper, asking only for people who were eligible for enlistment in the Canadian Armed Forces to do so, namely subjects of the British Empire. So it sort of pretended that what they were doing was just recruiting Canadians, right? And they're not really recruiting Americans. But they never asked, actually, whether the people they were signing up were Americans or Canadians. And these offices were, by the way, in the United States. And so this was all sort of a big wink. And it was actually a deliberate plot. An agreement between Hughes and an American Brigadier General, Clinton Edgar, that basically tells the recruiting officer, you know, at some point you will get an indignant letter telling you to cease immediately, and you will, quote, plead village idiot in response. After the war, the recruiting officer, a man named Hoare, said, irregular? Yes, but we got ever so many men. Now, how many is a matter of great mystery, and it's a question I think that historians will never be able to answer. That Hoare himself, the military recruiting officer, estimated 16,000. I think that's probably one of the best numbers. The official number, I think, is 455, which no one believes. And others have suggested numbers as high as 50,000, which are probably not quite accurate. Hoare's estimate of 16,000 is probably a little bit low, but it's probably closer. And why they did so? Many reasons. Some, by anecdotal evidence, were in fact unemployed and looking for a job, although there were plenty of other jobs to be had, so that might not be the explanation. Some wanted the adventure, the romance. They'd seen those newsreels of the Lafayette Escadrille and other such things. One, Lieutenant Pat O'Brien, went to Canada to join the Royal Flying Corps because he was, quote, tired of waiting for my own country to take her place with the Allies. Right? So some clearly were motivated by political reasons. One who joined, this is a story that may be familiar, is William Faulkner, right, who went to Canada in July of 1918, actually after the U.S. entered the war, and sought to join the Canadian Army. He had been exempted from service in the U.S., but mostly was frustrated because the woman that he was trying to marry had married another man, and he was frustrated and decided, well, I'm just going to go to Canada and join up there. He never actually ended up serving because the war ended before anything happened. Now, these are people who risked their citizenship to join, they risked their lives to join, and their critics at the time, whether those critics were German-Americans, whether they are pacifists or others, said these people are dragging America into the war through their reckless actions and their ideological dogmatism. That's probably correct, in fact. And in fact, their commitments and their actions, independent of and in violation of U.S. law, did contribute to dragging the United States into war in April 1917, an action that the United States would have taken regardless. But nevertheless, I think it's important to say these things made a difference. All right, so, one more picture, right, just on motivation. Right, this is the picture of the American Legion. Come on, boys, it's our chance to get in this war thing. Right, so apparently that was an explanation given at the time. All right, so now I want to conclude that Americans were engaged in World War I long before the U.S. officially joined the war, through observation, through donation, through action, and there were legacies. One of those legacies was immediate. The division and the passion of the neutrality period carries over into the crisis of April 1917 and the decision to go to war. It also generates the conflicts of the 1916 election, which was the closest presidential election of the century, depending on whether you think 2000 was in the 20th century or the 21st. And it reflects and it generates in many ways the sort of the urgency and the passion with which Americans would fight over the war as it was happening. The conflicts on the home front, the repression of anti-war voices and others. Now, much of that is lost, and I think some of the blame for that goes to F. Scott Fitzgerald. And I want to read you a short passage, and this is from F. Scott Fitzgerald's first novel, This Side of Paradise, which is a loosely autobiographical novel in which the main character, Amory Blaine, is a student at Princeton University. And in chapter 2, there's a brief paragraph set aside from the others with some white space with the heading, Historical. The war began in the summer following his freshman year. Beyond a sporting interest in the German clash for Paris, the whole affair failed either to thrill or interest him. With the attitude he might have held toward an amusing melodrama, he hoped it would be long and bloody. If it had not continued, he would have felt like an irate ticket holder at a prize fight where the principals refused to mix it up. That was his total reaction. That's the myth of American response to the war in 1914, right, of sideline spectatorship, mass-mediated amusement, and utter indifference to the outcome. Right? In fact, what I hope I've shown you is observation, donation, and action, a passionate engagement and something that we should bear in mind today as we are surrounded by wars and conflicts that once again we have to look for on maps. Our choices and our engagements will have consequences. Thank you.
We invite question and answer. Please feel free to walk down to a microphone. And the first question will start up here.
How did embassies such as the Belgium embassy respond to the volunteerism of the Americans, and how did they acknowledge it?
The sort of official diplomatic responses to American volunteerism were quite enthusiastic. Different countries have different levels of response, and certainly, the French were willing to enlist American soldiers, for example, but they wanted them in the French Foreign Legion, right? In sort of specifically in American forces, they certainly, the Belgians were incredibly, and remain to this day, in fact, actually incredibly thankful for the donations of food and medical supplies that, in fact, actually sort of kept them from starvation during the course of the war. Some of the most interesting artifacts that this generates, you can see some of them here at the museum, but in several other collections and images online, are of gestures of gratitude that Belgian people would send back to their donors in the United States and Canada and elsewhere. Where they might take those empty flour sacks that you saw there and embroider them. And in fact, they're beautiful sort of lacework, Belgian lacework and other things that would be done to sort of embroider these empty flour sacks. Or they might be turned into clothes, right, and worn. But this sort of sense of gratitude is I think, quite sincere. That sense of gratitude is also political, right? It solidifies an alliance and a sort of cultural exchange alliance between the U.S. and Belgium, between the U.S. and other countries that we aided, the U.S. and France. Although there are diplomatic tensions after the war, there's much sort of personal sort of good feeling. And certainly if we extend this to Armenians, right, sort of the Armenian community in Armenia and the Armenian diaspora community certainly took American charity quite seriously.
Yes, I'd like to make one comment. I belong to another 501c organization. We just got through celebrating the golden glow of Christmas past. And there is one woman from Chicago who in November of 1914 sent out a call to all of the children in America to raise gifts for the orphans and for the mothers. And the extent is that in 1914, November 14th, the 100 years this month, they sent 7 million gifts to not only the combatants, but also to the enemy. And it was the first American ship that sent donations to the war.
Oh, great. And say again the name of that organization, sir?
Golden Glow of Christmas Past.
All right. So, excellent. Yeah. And I think once you scratch the surface of almost any sort of charitable organization that's active today, you'll find actually important ways in which the World War I marked an important turning point in its experience. Now, take for example the American Red Cross, right? That had obviously existed before 1914, but the war marks a really important turning point in the history of that organization, in part because it's recognized officially by the government as sort of its official medical care group, right? And many other organizations can really are really transformed by this period.
Our last question.
Did the Americans who enlisted in the Canadian Army fight as separate units, American units, or were they integrated into Canadian units?
That's a good question, and the answer is yes. that many of them served in something that was called the American Legion until the name American Legion became somewhat problematic because it was making apparent that the Canadians were actively recruiting and enlisting U.S. citizens. So many of them, in fact, did actually fight in an American Legion, and some of the images depict that. Many of those who actually just crossed the border and signed up at their local recruiting station are lost to history, right? Especially if they have, there's no really easy way to distinguish an American name from a Canadian name. Many of them, you know, may have been born in Canada, they may have not filled out, you know, they may have put something else down on the form, so we don't really know. So large numbers of them, in fact, actually just completely disappear into the historical record and would have served right next to Canadian soldiers. Now, one thing, they end up basically not losing their citizenship in the end. For the most part, there are some sort of international agreements that essentially kind of backdate an agreement that say, you know, this is okay. But a handful do lose their citizenship, mostly if they commit crimes. But for the most part, the Foreign Enlistment Act is not actually sort of applied en masse against really any of these Americans who joined foreign forces.
Thank you, Dr. Chris Capozzola.